Iron Maiden was formed at a time when most people said heavy metal was dying. However, heavy metal and Iron Maiden have both managed to grow despite less than ideal conditions at times. And now the band finds itself headlining a world tour and headlining in the United States for the first time. Rockline welcomes Bruce Dickinson. Bruce, welcome to the program.
Hello, how are you, Bob?
I'm doing fine tonight. Glad to have you here. I understand that the bass player for the band, Steve Harris, is with you, too. Yes, hi, Steve.
He's the one with the brown hair sitting next to me.
How are you doing? All right.
So for those of you listening to the show tonight, Steve's the one with the brown hair.
Yeah, that's right. He's got a particularly nice pair of shoes on and a very nice matching shirt with his trousers.
Steve, you and guitarist Dave Murphy are the only original members of the band left. Is that correct?
Yeah, actually, it's Dave Murray.
It's Dave Murray, okay.
Yeah, and Murphy.
Bruce, I'm thinking of Dale Murphy from the Atlanta Braves. I don't know why. Bruce, you have been in the band for, what, a couple of years now? How long have you been in the group?
Yeah, 2 years.
We're going to listen to one of your songs to kick things off here, and then we'll put folks on the telephone on Rockline Nationwide with you. For right now, on the Global Satellite Network, our first tune by Iron Maiden, The Flight of Icarus.
Fly!
Flight of Icarus by Iron Maiden. Our first phone call tonight for Bruce and Steve is Christy. She's in Sanford, Florida, listening to WDIZ in Orlando. Christy, you're on the air.
Hi.
Hello.
Hello.
Wow.
Huh?
How are you?
All right.
Well, what do you want to ask?
I wanted to ask you where you got the idea to write a song about a character from mythology.
The which bit of mythology?
Yeah. I thought it was from mythology, you know, that he flew too close to the sun and he...
She's referring to Icarus,
That's right, yeah. Well, it was the kind of school I went to in England. They thought it was more important that you knew about mythology than sort of things like how to crack an egg and that sort of stuff. So we got taught that sort of stuff until I was about 13 or 14 years old. And it's quite a bit of it stays with you. You know the story about Icarus, do you?
Yeah,
it was the kid who flew too close to the sun, and his father made these wings for him out of wax, and when he flew too close to the sun, the wax melted, and he went down, a bit like a sort of, bit like a DC-10 or something like that, you know? And the moral of the story, right, was always do as your father says, otherwise you'll end up like Icarus. But I didn't really get off on his father too much, because I thought his father was a bit silly trying to make a kid go flying through the upper atmosphere without trying it himself first. So the song is a little bit anti his father, you know. I think it's a kind of irresponsible thing to do, you know. A bit like, you know, the album cover, you know, you're definitely not advised to try brain surgery on your younger sister with a saw or hand-powered drill or something like Eddie, you know. Don't try and imitate him, you know, it's a bad idea.
Thanks for the call, Christy. I want to let you know that we'll be joined by Fastway a little later on. And toward the end of the program, we'll have information about our rock adventure, A Journey with Journey to Hawaii. More coming up with Iron Maiden. Your number to call is toll-free, 800-421-3222. We're back live on the satellite. It's Rockline. I'm Bob Coburn in the Hollywood studio in Houston at KLOL is Bruce Dickinson and Steve Harris. Our next phone call from New Hartford, New York. Listening to Utica's WOUR, we have John on the line. Hi, John.
Hi. Hi, Bruce. Hi, Steve.
How you doing?
Hi, Mike.
All my friends from New Hartford said hi. They love you. The band has always been accused of backward masking in the past, and you haven't done this until the Peace of Mind album. Why did you put this on the album? And what does it say?
Well, it was, it wasn't really, it's not really a satanic message for a start. The reason we put a backwards message on, and the reason we put it so clearly as a backwards message between two songs, so there's no way anybody could possibly think it was anything else but a backwards message, was because we were fed up of people accusing us of putting backwards messages on where there weren't any. So we thought we'd put one on to give them something to talk about. The message actually says, don't meddle with things you don't understand, right? But if you want to know a real quick way to tell whether a record's got a backwards message on it or not, you could always try the way they used to try witches in the Middle Ages, actually. They used to throw them into a pool of water. And if they sank and drowned, then they weren't witches. So, you know, get a couple of albums and throw them in, and if they sink, you know, they're usually guaranteed to have a backwards message on, or not, as the case may be. But, I mean, ask the witches about that, the ones that survived. You know, they'll be quite happy to tell you, you know.
Boy, now, there's a no-win situation. And the message comes between the Trooper and Still Life on the LP, correct?
That's right, yeah.
Okay, let's go to Pittsburgh. That's what, or where Tracy is. She's listening to WDVE. And now, Tracy, you're in the program. Hi.
Hi.
Hello.
Hello. Hi. Did you feel like MTV would be more receptive to your videos rather than American radio to your records?
Yeah, I think so, because we hadn't really got a lot of radio play up to that point. And when they first started showing it, the videos on MTV, we had a lot of people calling in and saying that they really wanted to sort of see it and everything. And so I think it really helped sort of break us out here, you know. But now we're getting quite a lot of radio play, so we're getting a bit of both, so it's all right now.
Do you have any, quickly, a theory why you weren't getting the radio play for a while?
I think it was because probably we're not really a commercial band, and we don't release singles in America, because well, basically it's a vicious circle because we weren't getting radio play, we weren't releasing singles. So, really, I think it's just down to the fact that we're not really commercial. Perhaps we're a bit too heavy for the radio stations or something. I don't know. Or the programmers don't like us. I don't know what it is, but...
I think mainly the situation with American radio, they tend to go for this sort of corporate-sounding stuff. You know, a lot of the stuff tends to sound very... Every major radio record tends to influence a whole load of other records that all kind of sound alike, you know. And we've always gone out and we've always tried to sound like ourselves, and we never compromise for the purposes of airplay or anything else like that, which creates a few problems, but it keeps us and our fans a lot happier. You know, we sleep better at nights, you know.
I was going to say, there is no doubt about whether or not this is Iron Maiden. Title track of this album, The Number of the Beast, on Rockline.
I left alone. My mind was blank. From my mind, what did I see? Could I believe that what I saw that night was real and not just fantasy? Just what I saw in my old dreams, were they reflections of my woman staring back at me? Cause in my dreams, night was black, was no use holding.
Title track of the LP, The Number of the Beast by Iron Maiden. Heavy Metal Night on Rockline. I'm Bob Coburn. Back to the telephones. We go to Omaha this time. Z92 is our station there, and it's Terry's turn. Hello.
Hi.
Hello.
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 I was wondering, on all your records, you have that little symbol, the little circle with the arrow pointing down to the line and the two circles to the side, and I was wondering if that had any meaning at all.
Well, actually, it's the artist's symbol. This is Steve talking, by the way. A lot of people actually ask us what that is, but he did try to explain it to me. It's apparently some sort of Egyptian symbol. He went into about an hour's discussion about it, and I couldn't really understand what he was going on about. But basically, you know, it's his sign. He's adopted that as his symbol for his artwork.
Yeah, it's actually the... it's from a book called the Kabbalah, right? Which is an old Jewish mystical book. And it's a thing called the Supernal Triangle, which is the top three houses in this book called the Kabbalah. It's quite common. It's a bit like, it's similar to kind of Buddhism, you know, but it's quite mystical and religious and all that kind of stuff.
Good call, Terry. Thanks. St. Louis is where we're headed this time. We have Kim listening, and she's about to be on the show. She's listening to KWK. Hi, Kim.
Hi. Hi, Steve. Hi, Bruce.
Hello,
you?
Kim.
Okay, I was wondering for the reason why Clive Burr left.
Mm-hmm.
Clive Burr.
Clive. Uh-huh. Yeah, Clive basically had a few problems with the touring side of Iron Maiden. We tour like 9 months of the year, and he had a lot of personal problems and a lot of things he wanted to sort out at home. And if you're not really, really happy touring 9 months of the year, it's really not the way just to go out and do it, because it can affect you really badly. It's not the sort of thing that you do just for a job. You have to go out, you have to enjoy it, you have to love doing it, because otherwise you can really be badly affected by it personally. And he just felt that he wanted to be at home, he wanted to be in England, and so it was really a mutual decision on both our parts, because we have to tour, you know. It's the band, it's the music, it's what we have to do.
We'll have more coming up with Iron Maiden. We'll be joined by Fastway a little later on, and that information about the rock adventure, A Journey with Journey to Hawaii, coming up toward the end of the show. Again, your number is toll-free, and we're live, so give us a call right now, 800-421-3222. Next week on Rockline Supertramp, the week after Journey, and coming soon, Brian Adams, Asia, Men at Work, and a whole lot more. More with Iron Maiden after a song from their fourth LP, Peace of Mind, The Trooper on Rockline. It's Rockline on the Global Satellite Network from Peace of Mind, The Trooper by Iron Maiden. We're with Bruce Dickinson and Steve Harris, and our next phone call is from Los Angeles. Eric is listening to 95.5 KLOS, and Eric, you're on.
Oh, my God, Bruce, Steve, I can't believe I'm talking to you guys. Hey, I'm like,
how are you?
How are you? How are you this evening?
Very well, thank you, Eric.
Great. I'd love to congratulate you on your excellent new album, and I'd like to talk to Steve. I believe you're the writer of The Trooper, am I correct?
That's right, yeah.
Trooper?
Yeah.
Okay, I think it's an excellent album. I think it's a fantastic song, and my question is for you. The song obviously deals with war and pain and death and suffering and all, and what I'd like to know is whether or not any of you are veterans of a war, or you know, what exactly is the story behind the song?
The actual story behind the song is it's from the Crimean War, and it's all about the charge of the Light Brigade, where the 600 cavalry just were given the order to go into the fight against the Russian guns, and they knew that they were going to their death. And basically the song is sort of an anti-war thing, really, because it just sort of shows how futile sometimes orders are when you just, you know, that's it. It's like you've got to go, and you know you're going to die, but you've just got to go anyway. So really, it was just a kind of anti-war thing.
Thanks for the call, Eric. I think Eric is one of your fans. I got that feeling. We now go to Hudson, Wisconsin, listening to 92 KQRS out of Minneapolis. We have Troy on the line. Troy, it's your turn.
Yeah, Bruce.
Hi, Troy.
Well, how did you feel after joining Iron Maiden after Paul Di'Anno left, the pressures of joining the group after he left? What, you know, you anything to say about what happened?
Yeah, well, the way it happened was all fairly informal, really. I was with a band called Samson before I was with Iron Maiden. And Steve and all the guys in Maiden, we all sort of knew each other because we'd recorded albums next door in studios next door to each other, the two bands. And I was fairly much at a loose end, and Steve came up to me and said, we're thinking of changing the singer. Would you be interested? And I said, well, yes, I would, because it's my kind of band. It's the sort of music I want to play. And I just went in there with open eyes and did what I did. I never tried to really be like anybody else except myself. And I thought, well, if people like it, well, great. If people don't like it, I suppose I'll have to go back to sweeping the streets or something like that, or selling encyclopedias, you know? But thank goodness for everything. I mean, everybody seemed to like it. Certainly all the old material, all the stuff of Killers and Iron Maiden is exactly the sort of songs that that I was singing anyway, and that kind of feeling, the kind of energy and the kind of intensity that we put into the live show, that was the sort of thing I wanted to be doing. So I didn't really feel that much pressure, because it did come kind of naturally to the sort of way I wanted to be.
We have one Steve on the show as a guest, another waiting to talk to, Steve Van Bruce. He's in Toledo listening to FM 104. Hi.
Hi. What's going on,
guys? Doing? Not a lot in here at the moment.
Yeah, well, I know that the guy on your album's name is Eddie, and I was wondering, why did you name him that, and what's he supposed to symbolize?
Eddie, you see, in East London, nobody says the word H. So if we said head, we say Ed. And that's how the word Eddie came about, because originally the band had a backdrop at the back of the stage, and it was just this a thing called a kabuki mask, which is like a Japanese mask. And when Derek Riggs, the artist, kind of did a painting for the band, it became Eddie, which was the character, and everybody called it Eddie the Ed. And so from that, he just became Eddie. And then we kind of brought him to life, you see. Eddie does anything outrageous that that we want to do. All we do is we just give it to Eddie, and he does it much more outrageously than any of us could ever manage, you know. You want to eat a bat, you know, you want to tear the head off a cow, you want to tear the head off Godzilla, you know, King Kong. Just let Eddie do it, no problem, you know. It gets us out of a lot of trouble, you know. We don't get arrested nearly so often since Eddie, you know.
Now that we've heard about Iron Maiden's alter ego, let's listen to one of their songs from the LP Killers, Wrathchild, on Rockline.
Execution.
Chateau Lafitte, Iron Maiden, 81, Wrathchild or Rothschild, if you want to call it that way, on Rockline. I'm Bob Coburn. Our next phone call from Portland, Oregon, KRCK is our station. Sam, you're on.
Hi, how's it going, guys?
How you doing?
Just fine.
Hi.
Susie and Lauren, say hello.
Okay, and what's your question, Sam?
My question is, I was going to ask, do you think that being accused of being Satan worshippers has helped or hurt Iron Maiden?
Sam is not turning his radio down, I think, and he's asking if being accused of being Satan worshippers have helped or hindered the band throughout the years.
Well, first of all, I think we should all say on behalf of everybody in the band that we are most definitely not, never have been, and never considered the remote possibility of ever being Satan worshippers, right? This is for the record, so I don't expect the subject to ever appear again in print. I don't suppose anybody will take any notice of that. I mean, it'll probably appear tomorrow, but I don't think being accused of being a Satan worshipper helps your career particularly. I think it probably helps the career of one or two hellfire preachers who really have run out of things to preach about for a while and want to swell their congregations or possibly their pockets, you know, with a little bit extra cash or whatever in the fight against satanic heavy rock or something. But I really don't believe it helps our career particularly. We're not interested in all that, you know. We're musicians, right? We're heavy rock musicians. We believe in what we do, and we play heavy metal because we love it, not because, you know, we're agents of the devil or some rubbish like that. I mean, I think most of the kids who listen to our stuff know that these guys who are accusing us of being Satanists are just idiots, you know. They're just in it to make a fast buck and to get a bit of publicity for their own cause, which I don't think very many people in the United States really support anyway.
You know, I find it ironic in that so far we've heard a song taken from mythology, another that's based on the Crimean War. You're too diverse and articulate to get hung up in other things. Let's move on with another phone call. Enough of that. We go to Connecticut this time. WHCN in Hartford is our affiliate, and we have Anita up. Hi.
Hi, Steve. Hi, Bruce.
Hey,
up until this record, you haven't really gotten an airplay in America. How did you get to be such superstars in England with even less airplay there?
We get less airplay in England than we do over here. Steve, tell them about it.
Yeah, actually, it's really crazy. I mean, if you think you've got it bad over here for airplay, well, I mean, it is laughable because in Britain, it's just no play at all. They have one rock show a week, which is like a two-hour thing on a Friday night when everybody goes out. So everybody misses it anyway. And so basically the bands just break through by playing pubs and clubs and, you know, just building up a following that way by playing all over the country from a grassroots level, really. There's no play. You can't guarantee you're going to get any play at all. I mean, we had a top 10 hit single with Run to the Hills, and I think it was played twice.
Unbelievable. What we have coming... Go ahead.
Yeah, I tell you, if you go to England... really expect a shock. You can tune your dial in all day long and all you will get is the most dreadful nonsense. I mean, you'll get the Carpenters, you know, 24 hours a day. It's awful, you know.
We're going to listen to a song now from the latest LP by Iron Maiden, Peace of Mind. This one is called Still Life on Rockline. More conversation after this. Thank you. That one is called Still Life on Rockline. I'm Bob Coburn. We're with Bruce Dickinson and Steve Harris from Iron Maiden. Our next phone call from Atlanta, GA. 96 Rock is our affiliate, and we have Daryl up this time. Hiya.
Hi.
Hey,
Daryl.
What?
Hi.
Bruce.
You're on the air, Daryl. What's your question?
Where did you get the name Iron Maiden?
Well, actually, it comes from a medieval torture device. It's like a big case with spikes in it, and you put somebody in it, and then you shut the doors on them, and it's pretty fatal. Basically,
you come out looking like rice pudding and jam, you know, at the other
sort of. But it's really the idea came about from the film called The Man in the Iron Mask, the original film.
Thanks for the call, Daryl. Frank, you're next. He's in Houston, where you guys are listening to KLOL. You're on.
Yes. I saw you in concert last night in Houston at the Coliseum with Fastlane Saxon. After hearing both of those bands, do you think the audience is revved up enough by the time you get on stage? And what are your feelings about being the third heavy rock band in a row?
I didn't quite catch that.
Were you saying that the songs... What?
Try again, Frank. Could you repeat it?
Yes. I saw you in concert last night in Houston at the Coliseum with Fastway and Saxon. After hearing both of those bands, do you think the audience is revved up enough by the time you get on stage? And what are your feelings about being the third heavy rock band in a row?
Well, I think it's great. Don't you think it's great? Did you enjoy the show?
I did, a lot.
Great. Well, that's all there is to say about it, really. I mean, hey, look, Fastway and Saxon are two real good bands, right? And that's why we chose them to open up for us, because we don't like having... I know some acts like to have groups that, you know, that aren't really too good to open up for them, you know? Maybe they paid money to get on the tour or something like that because they thought it would do them some good. We're calling the British Metal Onslaught. All three bands are British, and we're steaming out there, and the whole idea is from 7:30 kickoff to, it's like a 4-hour show, to the time we go off stage, it's like real good class English heavy metal music. And the fact that we close the show, obviously it's our light show and everything like that. And okay, a lot of the people have come to see us, but I hope they come to see the other two bands as well and give everybody a good evening, because we're not in it for the ride, you know. We like to deliver and be seen to deliver on our merits and on our merits alone. Does that answer your question?
Yes, thank you.
All right, thanks for the call, Frank. One of those two bands will join us momentarily, Fastway. Information toward the end of the show about the rock adventure Journey with Journey to Hawaii. Stay tuned for that. And more Iron Maiden music and conversation right after this. Call us toll-free, 800-421-3222. From the LP, The Number of the Beast, Run to the Hills on Rockline on the Global Satellite Network.
Yeah.
I call a speeding ticket song, because when I'm in my car, I get one when that's on. Run to the Hills, Iron Maiden on Rockline. Let's go to Flint, Michigan. Donna is listening to WWCK. Hi, Donna.
Hello. I was wondering in this song, Run to the Hills, if that was an Indian-based song, and why?
Well, actually, it's just we had this feeling that the American Indians seem to get a bit of a raw deal. And all the films and sort of stuff you see seems to sort of depict the Indian as the bad guy. And we weren't really sure that that was always the way, you know? So we just thought we'd like to write a song about the other side of it sort of thing.
Good call, Donna. Thanks. We have another one for you in Davenport, Iowa, is where Daryl is. He's listening to 97X. Hello.
Hi, how you doing?
Hello.
Hi. Hi. I was wondering, your new album, Peace of Mind, is centered around a warlike theme, and I was wondering if you had set out to make a concept album.
Not really. A lot of people get that idea because the cover concepts tend to tie in. We got asked a lot of questions about the Killers album and the Number of the Beast album. If they were both concept albums, you know, people would go, oh, the Number of the Beast album was obviously based around the devil and Killers was based around violence. That's not the case. We just write each song more or less as it comes up. The only song that I can think of on the new album, on Peace of Mind, that is about war, specifically, is The Trooper, actually. Which other songs were you thinking about?
Land, or Where Eagles Dare.
Well, yeah, Where Eagles Dare is based on a war movie, yeah. But that part of those two, To Tame a Land, is actually based on a book called Dune by a guy called Frank Herbert, right, which is a science fiction book.
Great book.
But it is a good book. We had so much trouble, though, because all the lyrics in the song are specifically about and taken from that book. And if you haven't read the book, or if you don't know it's about the book, some of the words might seem a little bit strange. We actually asked permission of the author, Frank Herbert, if he minded us calling the song Dune. And he had this real thing that he didn't like heavy rock, and he didn't like the idea of Iron Maiden calling the track Dune after his book, despite the fact that apparently he's making a big movie out of it and all these other kind of guys are making a lot of money out of his book and everything. We just wanted to call the track Dune because it was about the book, but he denied permission, so we had to call it To Tame a Land at the last minute. It really disappointed us, you know, but... You know, that's people for you. I suppose he's entitled to his opinion, you know?
Well, if anybody's learned anything tonight, I hope it's this, that Iron Maiden plays heavy metal with a vengeance, and they also draw from a very humanistic and historical viewpoint for their lyrics. And I want to thank you guys for that. You have some social conscience. It's appreciated. And thanks for being on the show, too. Bruce Dickinson and Steve Harris from Iron Maiden. It's been a pleasure, you guys.
Thank you very much, Bob.
All right.
Enjoyed it. A great deal.
All right, good. Come back again. We'd love to have you again.